Hello, welcome to the first in this series on Unity modding tutorials. Today I'm going to teach you just the very basics of looking for games that were made in Unity and dealing with them using various modding tools that have been created over the years. First off, let's examine what a Unity game directory looks like. So we have here a game that I find quite nice, Soda Drinker Pro. The key thing that you're going to be looking for is this directory, which is given the game's name underscore data. This tells us immediately, right off the bat, this game was made in Unity. You'll often also see something like Unity Crash Handler 64.exe. This game doesn't have it, but a lot of Unity games do. That's another immediate tell of what you're working with. If we go inside this directory, we'll see this is essentially where all of the game's data is stored. These different files that say assets and level, this is where all of the game's assets are stored, unsurprisingly. So that's where you'll find things like 3D models, textures, sounds, animations, the works. But if you're looking for the game's code, it'll be in this folder called Manage. This file right here, assembly-c#.dll. This will usually, not always, usually contain almost all of the game's core code. Everything else here, almost everything else, excepting these other three DLL files. This is where all of the game's libraries are coming from. You might find some of the game's actual code here if it's being written as sort of a library of itself, or class, or however else. It depends on the exact implementation. But usually it will all just be in this one file, this one at the very top, assembly-c#.dll. Next we'll go into some tools that you can use to really dig into the guts of any game that was made in Unity. First off, we're going to be starting with this one called DevXUnity. Now this is a tool, I have to get this out of the way, this tool is quite expensive. Now I've pulled it up here for you so you can see the kinds of prices that they're charging. You can see these are very, very expensive things. These are in US dollars, so the most basic versions of this tool are going to be costing you at least $40. This is for the unpacker, which is designed to sort of unpack certain assets. This doesn't include stuff like code, plus you have to pay additional for getting regular updates. And if you want stuff like full decompilation and recovery, it could cost you as much as $600. Now, I'm not saying that it isn't worth the price, but you're not the target customer. This is meant for game studios. So if somebody loses the entire code base, they at least have this option as sort of a last resort. And they spend the $600 and it's a lot cheaper than just straight up making their game a second time. It's not really targeted at modders. It's not really for you. But if you can afford it, I do recommend it. I've heard it's quite powerful in its full version. But even just the demo version, which we can see here that I've got, even just this version of the tool is very, very helpful. Because what the thing it does do, even for free, if you have the demo version, is it will allow you to view the Unity project as it exists in this compiled game. So if we open game directory and we navigate to the directory of our game, first let's go back to the desktop, Soda Drinker Pro, and if we open this data directory, it will give us a whole bunch of options. You can see this is definitely a $600 product. These different color codes represent different version specific features. Everything that's not colored I can just use in any version of this tool. And it's going to be working for a while. It's going to be doing quite a lot. This is a very complicated game. Or a very complicated program, I should say. It's going to take a minute to complete. I'll go ahead and cut to when that's finished. Alright, it doesn't look like a lot has changed, but we've actually finished the loading process. you can see here at this left-hand side of the window, I actually have some things that I can start to look at. I can look at the whole data. I can see all of these different individual asset files, which we were looking at earlier, but much more helpfully, I can actually view the different scenes in the game. So if I can go to any level I want to, I can go to, let's say, this one titled level 9, and I can see all of the different objects that are actually in that level. And if I click this button that says making 3D scene, you'll have to forgive some of the wording. This is actually translated. It will actually allow you to view a admittedly not great render of the level. The not greatness mostly just comes to it not being the purpose of the tool. You're really meant to either be working with this menu on the left-hand side here, or if you have one of the higher-end versions of this tool, extracting it and then just plopping it into Unity Editor itself, which is much better at this sort of thing. And it's very, very good as a sort of a view tool, even in this demo version, because you can actually see the layout of every scene in the game. And you can even do things like viewing the code. It takes a minute to decompile, though. Again, I'll just cut ahead here so you can see the finished results of that. It shouldn't take too long, though. And that finished. That only took about 8 seconds, something like that. And you can see now we actually get to see the C# code that was used to create this mono behavior, which is very, very helpful, actually, because now I know what this code file is called, what it does, and where it is in the scene, which is enormously helpful. In addition, on the left-hand side, for really just about anything, we also see the Unity properties that have been assigned to this object, whatever it happens to be, and what their values are. These correspond to the values that you'd have available to you when you are working in the Unity editor. These are the same, it's just that they're using the internal name here instead of the specific label that's being displayed in Unity. So that's another thing that can be very, very helpful if you know what to do with it. Next, we're going to look at the tool AssetRipper, or AssetStudio, rather. AssetRipper is a completely different tool. I tried to get working, but I just couldn't manage to on this computer. I've heard it's pretty good, but I can't verify that. AssetStudio, however, is a completely different tool. And what AssetStudio does is it helps you actually extract assets from Unity games. So if I navigate to SodaDrinker Pro again, and I open any one of these asset files, I can now actually start to look at all of the different assets that are in here. Compared to DevXUnity, it's a lot more bare bones. That's kind of why you want to have DevXUnity, at least a demo version, on hand, so that you can find what you're looking for in the nice fancy UI before you start trying to actually take anything out. So if, for example, let's say that I want to extract this cube. I would right-click, I would click Export Selected Assets, and let's just say Desktop Cube. Oh, hold on. I guess we should have just left that blank. And now we have this cube.obj3d file, just like that. That's a 3D file that we took out of the asset file, and now it's just on our computer. We can do whatever we want with it. Very, very nifty AssetStudio. Very, very useful. Now, a nice thing you can do is you can load an entire folder, and that will load all of the different asset files in the game at once, so you can just go hog wild. And that's actually very, very fast, and I have all of them open, and I can search for whatever asset I want. Very, very convenient. Next, we'll be looking at a tool that I've gotten some use out of called uTinyRipper. I've been told that AssetRipper, again, is sort of a replacement for this because this tool is kind of not very good. And when I say not very good, I don't mean that it isn't useful. It's enormously useful. It's just, it's got problems. I've heard it's not very compatible with newer versions of Unity. And also, this UI is not very intuitive. What you're supposed to do here is take all of these files that I'm just scrolling through. It's going to take a minute. You're supposed to take all these files, drag and drop them into the main window. And now it's going to load all of them, all of those asset files. It's importing them right now. All right, now that process is finished, we're given an option to open folder. And if we do, this is what we're greeted with. Just two folders. One's with assets, the other's with project settings. We open assets up and we see all sorts of stuff. For example, if we open the materials folder, we see all of these different materials, these .mat and .meta files. And at first, this might not look like much of anything, but if you've ever worked with Unity, you know right off the bat, this is actually how Unity asset files are stored in an actual project. And that has actually a really nice benefit. So if I start a new Unity project really, really quickly. All right, now we have our Unity project, and something very, very helpful is that now I can take these assets that I have exported and I can just do this. I can click and drag. And this is gonna slow my whole fucking computer to a crawl. You'll have to forgive me if there are some video issues in the final product because this part is really, really slow on my machine. And it's literally just going to import the entire game, the whole thing. All right, now that that process is finished, you can see that I've actually got Unity, my bit directory, my assets directory is full of stuff. I can go to any of these scenes that I've just imported and they'll be full of stuff. Which I'll have to take a minute to locate. There's our level. And boom. Here we go. I've got the whole game in a Unity project. However, it's not quite so simple. You can see that there's going to be some errors here. Right now, there's just one plus all these warnings. But this is one of those things where it's just going to stack a whole bunch of errors on you. The chances that you get a working game immediately right off the bat, not very good. That's very, very unlikely. And this especially happens when you get obfuscated code. This doesn't happen very often with the game itself. Usually, the game will have purchased some pre-made asset, which has a lot more incentive to obfuscate their code because there will be a bunch of different developers, and developers are very smart people, and if they don't obfuscate the code for their component, then developers will just steal it, and they'll change it enough that there isn't really a legal challenge you can mount, and it's just really annoying. So usually those asset makers will obfuscate their code, and because their code ends up included in the game, it doesn't it doesn't export right from something like uTinyRipper, and you really can't fix it. It's just an absolute mess to work with. But that is still a very helpful tool because now you have all these assets in an actual Unity project and you can do all sorts of stuff with them. I'll kind of leave it up to your imagination what to do with that sort of information. The last tool that we're going to talk about is going to be something called dnSpy. dnSpy is a bit different from these other tools in that it's actually meant for modifying code, which nothing else that we've talked about here is really all that good for. So if I go to my project folder, oh no, wait, that's the wrong folder, my bad. And I double click on this assembly c#.dll. Right now I have it associated so that dnSpy will just open any DLL file like that. Once it loads, of course. And it's very helpful. You can ignore the vast majority of what's on screen right now. Just this one DLL file is really most of what we need. And now we can see all of the different functions that were made, or classes rather, that were made for the game. And we can look at any one of them. We can do whatever we want with it. So we can look at, I don't know, Soda Drinker UI, and it will decompile the C# code. Very, very clean to read, very nice. And we can even edit it by clicking Edit and Edit Class. We get this nice window where we can actually start changing things here. And if we hit the Compile button, it will actually apply those changes. However, this is not how you should be modifying a Unity game. I'll talk about that in a later episode. It's just good to know that it's there, in case you have some other project where this might be more convenient. But when we're working with Unity, this should not be your default approach. dnSpy also works with other C# compiled stuff. So if you ever see any games that were made with XNA, it's also very useful there. And it's a very nice tool to have in general. But that just about wraps up our video. That's going to be it for today. I hope that getting you introduced to these basic tools, these basic Unity tools, will be something helpful. I think it's a great place to start. It gets your feet wet. It lets you start to look at projects and think about how you can start to make changes to them. And you'll have to ignore Unity. It's going to be having a bit of a fit for a minute. But I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you gained something out of it. I hope you learned something. And I'll see you for the next episode.